This is the Public Works Committee meeting. In attendance, we have Commissioner Bassanetto, Counselor Van Hazinger, and Counselor Schultz. We have 14 items on the agenda, and we are limited to 45 minutes for this meeting. And anything we don't get to, we will table for the next meeting. So let's begin with minutes from the previous meeting from July 28th. Do I have a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor, aye?
Aye.
Okay, approved. DPW, do we have any updates? Nick?
Yes, with DPW, I just wanted to let you know that as part of our sewer separation project, I'm sure you're quite aware how we're separating the sewer and the stormwater. We're moving, so we're planning on moving towards the Main Street and north of Main Street area coming up in 2023 to 2024. And that goes from Caldwell Park, right down Main Street to Pritchard, up to Blossom, Mount Vernon area, all the way up to Burbank. So that whole area is our next area for the sewer separation. That's going to be a lot of construction there. And so what happened is Unitil Gas will be starting next spring. They'll be starting to do their conversion of the old cast iron into the new steel gas pipeline through Main Street following, and it's going to be a three-year process. So for the next 3 years, starting in the spring, that whole area, Main Street and that whole neighborhood up there is going to be under construction by Unitil. And then the sewer separation project will come in between 2023, 24, and all the way to 2027 about. So you can expect a lot of construction in the next 7 years in that neighborhood. And, you know, we won't be doing a lot of paving up there just because it's all going to be torn up. The Elm Street sewer emergency project we just did is that area of the area that sewer was just falling apart, so we couldn't wait. And that's what we're just paving that section of Elm Street now. But I just wanted to make sure you guys are aware that a lot of construction is coming that way.
Okay, and there'll be plenty of public notices for the citizens of Fitchburg to be aware of what's going on. Great. All right. Well, why don't we get to our first item on the agenda? The first one is 088-20, Sergeant Daniel Boudreaux, Counselor Amy Green, Counselor Bernie Schultz, to amend Chapter 169 of the City Code, No Parking South Street to Burnap, South Street, South Side, starting 54 feet from South Street to Burnap Street, Kingsbury Street, Drury Lane, as outlined in the enclosed petition.
So I spoke with Sergeant Boudreaux from the Fitchburg Police Department, and this petition should actually be referred over to the Safety Committee.
Okay.
To the Public Safety Committee, because it just has to do with people parking to pick up their kids at South Street Element at the South Street School. So he said it should be over to that committee.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion to refer to Public Safety.
Second. Okay. All in, aye, and it's unanimous.
Aye.
Okay. 089-20. Councilor Bernie Schultz and resident Alex Freeman to remove the no turn on red sign at the intersection of John T. Centrino Memorial Drive and Water Street. It was referred from the Public Safety Committee.
Right. So we did go out and inspect this area. The reason that sign is there is because that intersection is actually offset. There's another road that comes down. It's Boyle Court, Hale Street, Boyle Court. And so that street comes down just on the other side of the old fire station. So when they get a green light, that's why the sign is there to no turn on red, because they have the right of way at that point.
Councilor Schultz.
Yeah, I was contacted by a resident, Alex Freeman, about this, and he thought that it would improve the flow of traffic if we were able to take that sign away. We weren't really sure. I guess when it went to public safety, we really weren't sure who actually put that sign up, whether it was the state or the city. And I don't know if Commissioner Bassanetto knows anything about the sign itself and the history of that sign. But I know that there's not too much traffic coming out of Boyle Court, but and I believe that when it was first put up, at least that's what the residents said, that the fire station was in operation. So it made perfect sense to have that sign there because the fire station was there, and they were in and out of that station a lot. So now that the station has been inactive and there's a business in there, there's really not much activity in that building anymore. So I think that's why he asked me to file a petition. So I think it would improve the flow of traffic if we could see our way to doing that.
You're absolutely correct. Allowing people to make a right on Red would increase the flow of traffic. I think people have enough room to pull up and see oncoming traffic on Water Street. So it would improve traffic. It just in the ordinance was written in 1992, like you're saying, that's probably when the fire station was still there. It's just, you know, right now the way the signal is set up, you know, you can't have it's more of a safety thing with Boyle Court coming down. So we could look at unsignalizing Boyle Court, putting a stop sign and maybe just making it a right out only.
Yeah, I think that might be a good idea, Nick. I think that might work because Boyle Court is really not used that much. So, I mean, it's not like this cars feeding out of there all the time into the traffic intersection. So, I think I'd like to see that happen.
I think that makes sense with the concern about Boyle Court. That's not something I had considered when looking at the no right on Red. But I do like the suggestion of making it a right turn only. Because any traffic going left can go downhill to Spruce Street. So it's not like they can't get to downtown.
Right.
I think and that works better for a left-hand turn there, I think, away from the intersection.
Yes, I agree with that, because that seems like to be a dangerous thing to be able to take a left turn out of Boyle Court.
So is this something we want to hold to further explore?
Yeah, does that make sense to hold this? And then if we make a change to Boyle Court, this may be back on the table. Does that make sense?
That makes sense. And maybe we could refer with that stipulation that we want to make Boyle Court a right turn only.
And so would that have to go back to safety?
No, so basically all the traffic signals are under DPW jurisdiction. Okay. So we're in control of the traffic signal. So any change like that, I always work with the police department anyways. So it's okay to hold it at the DPW committee. I'll go out, look at it, talk to the police department, and then come back and report back.
Okay, that sounds like a reasonable solution. Thank you, Nick.
Sure. All right. Make a motion.
I make a motion to hold the petition.
Second it.
All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. Petition 09020, Councilor Paul Bolschman and Anthony Zarella to request Unitil when removing trees, remove and grind stumps.
I think this is one that makes sense to me, and it's something I've complained about a lot. Whenever you see the Unitil crews trimming trees, they leave these giant stumps everywhere. I'm just curious about the exact mechanism to make them do this. I don't know if Commissioner, you have any clarification?
Yes. So I believe Superintendent Withington is on the line. Gary? All right. So I think I spoke. Go ahead, Gary.
Yeah, I've talked to Unitil, and 99 times out of 100, if the homeowner requests to have their stump ground, Unitil will try to do their best to get it done. They have ground some in the city.
So
I'll continue talking to them, but they take down so many trees that I don't know if they can get them off.
Yeah, it's not a fast process from what I understand, which is why we see a lot of trees not removed and the stump ground. I don't know the process personally, but that's what I've heard. There's a little bit.
It cost them a lot of money to take the trees down to begin with.
Right.
And they don't have to grind the stumps. But in good faith, they try to grind a lot of them.
So is it a liability to them if somebody should, you know, trip or injure themselves walking into a stump? Or, I mean, I know on one of our streets in Fitchburg, we have a man who is blind, walks with a walking cane. So is that a liability? Do we know?
I don't think it's ever come up. I don't know.
Okay. So how do we address this? If we hold it, do we get an assurance from Unitil that this is going to be done, or do we just move on the way it is, hoping they grind them and remove them?
Like I said, I've been working with them. I've been talking to them. Let me continue to talk to them and see what I can do.
Okay, so we want to put this on hold?
Yeah, I think that'd be the best.
Okay. Well,
it seems like the petition is not binding. It's just to request that they remove the stump. So I don't have a problem just passing it. If we can, you know, Gary is already requesting. I mean, doesn't do any harm.
Okay, and all right, Paul's, Councilor Boschman's not here to speak to it. So I
make a motion to approve 09020.
Second.
Okay, and I'm in favor. So it's unanimous.
Yeah.
Okay. Petition 0173-20. Councilors Marisa Fleming and Andrew Van Hezinger to increase the availability of on-street parking along Day Street. This was referred from public safety to DPW. And I know there's been some discussion with this. Do you want to speak to this?
Sure, just briefly. This is an area where there is a high demand for parking, both from commercial users, from the commercial condos on Main Street, and also residents who live in the area, in the multifamily buildings, such as Hotel Raymond or CJ Durkin Apartments. There is a municipal lot, but there's not a lot of space in it. It's primarily used by commercial people using the commercial building. So this was at a request of the Community Development Office to try to do something to get some more parking there. And it's a very wide road, and we're looking at, can we put in some parking? Right now it is, the petition does include converting it to fully one-way travel, but it does turn out that that's not needed, that it was never actually correctly changed to two-way travel at the end. So that's an unnecessary part of the petition that if we go further, we can remove. But the space at the southern end, the space possibly along Hotel Raymond, and there's some questions at public safety about whether or not there's sufficient width. So it got referred to here, and I'm interested to hear from Commissioner Bossanetto about his thoughts, and also input from other departments.
Yes, Councillor, thank you. As you mentioned, this was referred to us from the Public Safety Committee. I have spoken with both the Fitchburg Police Department and the Fitchburg Fire Department. As Councillor Van Hensinger correctly noted, that little section of two-way traffic was never legitimate. It was never done correctly, and it also was impeding traffic flow at the intersection because it kept giving green light to Day Street. So like all the traffic on Water Street and Main Street had to come to a stop for, you know, like 30 seconds while Day Street got green light. So we went ahead and removed the traffic signals. We put up do not enter signs. We made all the changes that needed to be changed. And the traffic at the intersection is actually working a lot better. The queues coming on Water Street at night are diminished significantly. So it has improved operations. They're just removing that. From a parking perspective, I did talk to the, so we were out there, we looked at the intersection. The one issue with the intersection, it's not a 90 degree turn from Main Street onto Day. It's actually, you know, like 110 degrees. And when the fire trucks come around, they sort of take up that whole, you know, they need that room to make the turn right in front of the barbershops. I talked to the barbershops also, and they did say, you know, when there was parking there, it was a little crunchy, is the way he described it. So we do feel that, you know, those little spots in front of the on the west side of Day Street, you do need that area to allow the fire trucks to make the turn. The fire department has reported that they respond about once or twice a day to the Fitchburg Housing Authority on Day Street. So they need to make that turn, you know, every day, at least once or twice. Those three parking spots there probably won't work. But we did talk to the fire and police, and what they thought was a good idea was to allow parking on the west side of Day Street, just past the entrance to the parking lot is, allow parking there where it's a no parking right now, and put the loading zone in front of the Hotel Raymond. And I think maybe this was discussed a little bit, but what that would allow is allow parking on the west side, and then I allowed the loading zone on the east side between Cherry Street and Main Street there.
Basically where it is right now.
I think.
Right where the loading zone is on the east side, right?
The loading zone's on the west side. So we would be moving it over to the east side and then putting in parking on the west side.
The only issue I have with that is that business where they're going to be, you know, they're unloading, I believe they're unloading with forklifts. So that's going to sort of, if there's traffic, going to be slowing up traffic. I think the beauty of keeping it on the other side was that the ease of going right into the business right from that side.
Right. Well, that's what both the fire and the police department were thinking. We could try it out, see how it works. Kind of evaluate how it flows from there. Their concern was, you know, when the fire trucks arrive at the Fitchburg Housing Authority, they have to stop in the middle of the street, and there's really no way to get out after that. So they, you know, they thought, you know, having a little bit more room to maneuver for people to make it onto Cherry Street. Also, you know, they have the big compartments on the truck, and then, you know, some of the trucks have the stabilizers that require extra space. So that's sort of the feedback that we had, and, you know, I think this approach of trying the parking on one side and the loading zone on the other side, you know, we can see how it works, you know.
I have a question.
Yeah. I'll start with Councilor Schultz.
Yeah, I was just wondering how often do they use that loading zone?
Daily, you know? I understand. Daily from the hours that posted, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
That could be an issue.
Yeah, it really could be an issue. Yeah, forklift trucks going across the street all the time might be a huge issue. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it might slow everything down considerably. Okay.
Okay, Councilor Van Hazinga?
So I'm curious, I'm wondering about the benefit of swapping the loading zone to the other side. One drawback is that there's sufficiently more parking available on the east side of the street in front of Hotel Raymond than there is in that loading zone. So if we can create parking over there, we get a greater bang for our buck to increase parking in the area. In terms of, you know, trying to preserve space for the fire trucks to get there, I mean, the CJ Durkin doesn't start until Cherry Street. So if there are trucks parked in front by the main entrance, they're most likely well past Cherry Street, I would think. There's also no parking on the side opposite, on the west side of Day Street past the loading zone, where it gets into the parking lot for Durkin, due to the entrances there. So if there is a little more root space there. And I think if you have to contend with the problem of cars who are parked unloading in front of Hotel Raymond, and you have to make space, I think it's you have to factor in the same thing, whether or not they're parked there for an extended period of time or if they're loading a fire truck coming. So I think my preference would be to make the parking on that side and keep the loading zone on the other side. Not quite sure of what the benefit would be.
Do we want to put this on hold?
Well, I guess One question for the commissioner is, what flexibility do we have to try stuff out? Like you had mentioned giving it a test run. Can we do that without passing the petition to just try it and see? Or do we need to pass something and see and then correct it later? Or what's the best course of action moving forward?
Yeah, so let me see here real quick. So this is something we did in Lowell quite a bit. Anytime we wanted to try something out, we passed what's called a 60-day trial. Mm-hmm. And in our ordinances, actually, we do have section 169-3. It's called experimental regulations. So it says, for periods of a trial, the city council may make temporary rules regulating traffic or post under actual condition, traffic signs, markers, or other devices. Any such experimental rule regulating traffic should remain in effect for a period of time not longer than 90 days. So you're actually able to make, and this is why we do this, is so we can try it out and see how it works mm-hmm. out. What happens is after 90 days, it expires. And then city council has to actually, you know, make it an official regulation. So you do have the ability to make experimental regulations.
Okay. Go ahead.
No, continue, and then I will.
So I guess we can, I think that would be a great idea to edit the petition to reflect the trial period. I think because this is fair enough. Let's give it a try and see if it poses problems or if not. So I think, how do people feel about keeping it the arrangement as proposed in the petition with parking on the east side or swapping it like Commissioner Bosnetto suggested?
I think I would be more in favor of keeping it on the east side. Like you said, there's more parking availability there, and having forklift trucks go across the street when they're loading, it just doesn't seem like it's going to work out too well.
Okay.
Especially when we have a really high community there with people with disabilities and you know, you've got all the housing units down there. I would feel more comfortable keeping it as it is.
As long as we've got enough room for the fire trucks to clear that, to make that turn, I think, you know, we should be good.
And just to say, that business does not have trucks there 8 hours a day. They're in and out. So it's, you know, there could be a truck there at 7 o'clock in the morning and then another one there at like 1 o'clock in the afternoon. So when by 4 o'clock, he said, they're pretty much 4 or 5, I believe he said that, they're not unloading as they do during the day. So
that's another question for the commissioner. Was there any comments about allowing off hours parking in the loading zone?
So with this neighborhood, and I know you had asked me about Wallace Avenue, how is it different with Wallace Avenue? Wallace Avenue is more of a institutional uses. You have, Monument Park, the YMCA, the courthouse. So at night, you don't have a lot of parking there. With this neighborhood, though, on Day Street, it's heavily residential. So at night, that's when you'll get all the cars parked there. I think the thought was to the loading zone would just be loading zone, no parking at night, and then the parking area would be for night parking. That way you do have that open space for everything to get through at night when the fire trucks need to get through.
Okay. So I would like to make a motion to edit the petition. To the proposal is to remove the first 3 bullets. That includes converting Day Street to one-way travel in its entirety, which is not needed. To allow short-term parking in the area of the barber shops by 2 Day Street, which was recommended against so that the fire trucks can turn onto the street. Then also to limit the nighttime parking in the loading zone. So the first 3 bullets would be removed.
So remove the first 3 bullets?
Yes.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Point of order.
Yes.
We're doing this as an under section 169-3 experimental regulations?
Yes, that would, I was gonna do that separate just to So I can check with you on the precise phrasing and everything on that.
Okay.
And that's only going to be for the parking, not for the loading zone. The loading zone is going to stay where it is.
Correct.
Okay. Anything else before we approve?
No, I'm sorry. This was a motion to...
To amend.
To amend, yes.
To amend. Okay, all in favor of the amending?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, it's unanimous.
Now, Commissioner, what was the mechanism for doing the temporary? How should we add that?
Right. So the mechanism for doing it is you would it's a experimental regulation to last not longer than 90 days. So you could say a 60 days is 2 months. So that's another thing. When winter comes and we start getting snow, you know, snow on the side of the road, the road gets narrower, people park more in the streets. So you could make it 60 days, 90 days, and then upon expiration, then it just goes away and you would have to.
Okay, my thoughts are, what if we insert that for 90 days and then in 60 days we come back and evaluate, and that gives us some time to either make it permanent without interruption or we can take it off. Does that make sense to everybody?
Yep.
Okay, so this will go towards the amending, and yep. Now we're going to make a motion to approve the amendment.
So we're making a separate motion to amend.
Yeah.
So the first one was to exclude those aspects that weren't going to work. This motion is to add that this will be done under the experimental regulation not to last longer than 90 days.
Seconded.
With reevaluation after 60 days.
Okay.
Internal reassessment.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, it's unanimous. Okay, so now petition 19420, Councillor Andrew Van Hezinga on behalf of James Cormier.
I'm sorry, do we need to vote to approve? Okay. Or make a motion to approve?
I thought they did.
That was for the amendment.
Oh, okay. Okay, I thought we did too, so okay. So motion to approve.
Motion to approve 17320 as amended.
Second.
And all in favor?
Aye.
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 All right, thank you, sorry.
Sorry. 19420, Councilor Van Hezinga, who on behalf of James Cormier to repair the sidewalk along Blossom Street between Elm Street and Mechanic Street. Would you like to speak to this?
Sure. So I was contacted by a resident who lives at the corner of Elm and Blossom Street. This is at the northern end off of Mechanic Street. And there is a sidewalk there that runs from Mechanic Street to Elm and then almost to Marshall Street. And it is in rough shape, particularly in the area around 708 Blossom Street, I believe it is. You can see where the sidewalk is actually sunken, and there are concrete panels that appear to be missing or just completely covered. I'm talking to the resident, not Mr. Cormier, but the resident who lives opposite Elm Street on Blossom. There's a lot of sand that washes out of the street and into their yard just because the sidewalk is so deteriorated and sunken down that everything just comes in and they're constantly cleaning that up. And I know there is no shortage of sidewalks to do in the city, but you know, this is one that hopefully could get added to the list and hopefully in its entirety. But I think that one section on Blossom Street, just west of Elm, is really the worst section that needs to be done.
Commissioner?
Yeah, so in our budget we have $17,000 for sidewalk improvements, for sidewalk repairs for the whole year. That's about 300 feet of sidewalks if DPW does it ourselves. We do have a long list. I don't object to this being added to the list, with the understanding that there's a backlog and there's only $17,000 a year. So it might be a while until we get there.
And that's completely understandable. My only thoughts are, even if it just cut down to that little 20-foot section right there, that's the highest priority, then the rest comes later. I think it'd be great appreciated by the residents there.
We have a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Oh. Okay, it's unanimous. Petition 0195-20, Councillor Andrew Van Huizinga on behalf of James Cormier to install a guardrail along Blossom Street and at 612 Elm Street.
So this is actually in the same area. There last spring, last March, according to the resident, there was a light snowstorm and a car skidded down Blossom Street, went over the sidewalk and into the side of the house, and took out a chimney. If you drive past recently, the whole side of the house is being repaired as we speak. So it's just an issue that there's a steep road there that, you know, it's on the north side of the hill, doesn't get as much sun. It is dangerous when there's snow and ice, and the resident's concerned and would, you know, feel some protections warranted there.
I'd like to speak to this, if you don't mind. We've had this issue on a couple of other of our roads, actually one of them in my ward on John Fitch Highway, near the Pearl Street, John Fitch Highway area. And I believe we had the same issue on Rollstone Road. And we didn't put guardrails though, I believe. I know in my ward, it was large rocks they put to sort of deter someone going into the house. I don't know which is the best route to go, which is more economical, but efficient. That would be more of a question for the commissioner.
Yes, Councillor. So guardrails are safety measures, safety instruments, let's say. Putting a rock on the side of the road is not safe at all. It's not something we would do. It would just, you know, it just creates a hazard for anybody that leaves the road with the hit, and it's not in any way crash worthy. A guardrail, a well-built guardrail actually prevents damage to the car and injury to the person. So if we want to put out guardrail, if you want to do it, you know, in an appropriate manner, it is costly. The whole system is to keep the road, keep the car on the road, and keep the passengers safe. We don't mind doing guardrails, but it is expensive. And like I said, we would have to maybe, do a program where we go around fixing guardrails. Right now, we don't have funds dedicated, a dedicated line item for guardrail improvements. I think we should. There's a lot of guardrails throughout the city. It's very hilly. So that's maybe something that we need to work on in future budgets. I have no objection, you know, to this petition's being put on, just with the understanding that it's going to take some time to get the guardrails.
I have a motion to approve.
Make a motion to approve 195-20.
Seconded.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay, it's passed. Petition 0196-20. Councilors DiNatale and Schultz on behalf of Elizabeth Carbone to install a new berm at 261 Alby Street to replace the sidewalk in front of the same address. Oh, and replace the sidewalk at the same address. Councilor Schultz?
Yeah, I didn't get a chance to talk to Councilor DiNatale about that. He's the person that initially talked to Elizabeth Carbone, I guess, about this. So I really don't have any information on this.
Commissioner?
I believe Superintendent Withington.
Okay.
Yeah, I talked to Councilor DiNatale and I took a ride up there. In 261, we paved the road so many times. This area he's referring to is actually higher than the road, so they always have a lot of tunnel in front of their house. And there wasn't a sidewalk there at one point. So to reinstall, all you need to do is put a berm and then put a hot mix sidewalk on top of it.
And is that feasible at this time?
At this time of year, I got my hot mix crew is pretty much busy for the rest of this year. It's something we would address in the spring.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous. Petition 0197-20. Councilor Paul Boschman to have a berm placed in front of 107 to 93 York Ave and have an apron added to the driveway on 101 York Avenue to 1017 York Avenue due to washed out caused by rainwater.
That might be a typo, Marissa. That might be 107.
107. Okay, let's, yeah, it says 1017. So
yeah, it's 107.
Okay. So we need to make a motion to amend the address.
So moved.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Once again, I'm out there, I'm familiar with this. Over the years, we paved that, and the rainwater, every time it rains, keeps washing out the front of their property and washing out their driveway. So the easiest way to fix that is put a berm and an apron in front of it.
And we can do this with the funds?
Like I said, we can do it in the spring.
Okay.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Did we make a motion to approve the amending of the amendment to the address?
No, I guess we didn't. We could do that as well.
Okay. So we'll make a motion for the amendment and for the approval of the petition.
Yes.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. I'm just, we'll get some time here. So petition 0198-20, Councillor Andrew Van Hezinger and Suzette Roman to repair the sidewalk at 153 Pritchard Street.
So this is another area on Pritchard Street, just north between Wallace and Grove. There's a section of the sidewalk, particularly at the driveway at 153 Pritchard, that is all torn up and uneven. There's actually a disabled resident who lives in that home. Who has had trouble traversing it and actually fell out of their chair there. So it does pose a danger. Just the table commissioner, I don't know, or the superintendent about what can be done to, I know it is at sort of a driveway access. Just curious what can be done to make that a little safer for the people who walk the sidewalks down there.
We can go down there and just repair that.
Okay.
So we have a motion.
Motion to approve.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Unanimous. Petition 0199-20. Councillor Andrew Van Hezinger and Suzette Roman to repair the sidewalk at 100 Elm Street.
I think this one might not be relevant anymore. Since I submitted the petition, it looks like the state already repaired the sidewalk. Or was working on it. This is the area directly in front of the courthouse.
Okay.
Yes, that's so the state is doing the sidewalks in front of the courthouse, and they're also doing the ramp, you know, the ramp that kind of switches back into the courthouse. It's all an ADA improvement. And yeah, so all those sidewalks are being done by the state.
Yeah, so this is accomplishing it. So I would motion to give this leave to withdraw. It's not
seconded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Oh, unanimous. Petition 213-20. Councilor Paul Boschman to petition the city to repair the sidewalk at 204 and 208 Plymouth Street in order to allow wheelchair egress.
All right. Once again, this sidewalk's in really bad shape, and this person can't get out of their house without the wheelchair. So this one and the one on Pritchard Street, I want to try and both get done this fall.
Make a motion to approve.
Seconded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
It's unanimous. Petition 218-20, Councilor Paul Boschman to petition the city to add an apron at 186 Daniel Street to avoid car bottoming out. And Commissioner?
Yes, Superintendent Whittington has looked at this one. I think he muted his phone because the radio dispatch was coming on. But basically, the whole concrete apron in front of the Daniel Street address is completely destroyed. We were thinking about, Superintendent Whittington is back online here.
Yeah, I am. And all I want to do this year is put a little hot mix in there so she can get in and out of a driveway for the winter. And come next spring, we'll give her a new concrete apron so she can stop bottoming me out on a car.
Okay, we got a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous. Petition 219-20, Councilor Paul Boschman to add a street light to pole number 22 located at the corner of Oak Hill Road and Pratt Road. There has been one on the pole in the past.
Yes, so we have contacted Unitil about this light, and we think it's, let me look my notes here. So we did contact Unitil about adding a light on that pole, and they said we have a light in stock. It's gonna cost about $1,400 to put the light on, but it is a sort of a safety issue because of the intersection. So we think it should be done.
Make a motion to approve.
Seconded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous. Motion passes. Petition 220-20, Councilor Marisa Fleming, for Sean and Daniela Valancourt to install a berm at 599 Pearl Hill Road to prevent water runoff from the street. So this is a situation where the yard is getting damaged because of the water runoff, and anybody who knows Pearl Hill Road knows when it rains, the water is a river flowing down.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
Are we able to do that? Commissioner?
I mean, that would probably have to be done in the spring.
Yes, Pearl Hill Road needs a lot of help with the drainage issue. Yep. I mean, this is sort of a band-aid on a big problem, but I mean, we could do it, but it's gonna, you know, it needs a permanent solution. Pearl Hill Road needs a much bigger project.
Okay, but we can pass it and for now and sort of
put it on the list.
Okay. Do I have a motion? Motion to approve. Second?
Second.
Thank you, it's unanimous. Okay, we held position 04620, Council Marisa Fleming and Marcus Di Natale to declare Ethia a public way. I'll speak to this one. We can continue to hold this until we have, you know, our correspondence with the owner of Ethier Street and to continue with what we need to do. And we've had no success with that, correct?
We haven't heard anything. I think this is with the city solicitor awaiting to get contacted by the developer.
Okay, so a motion to continue to hold. Can I get that? Moved. Okay, all
Seconded.
Those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, it's unanimous. And the 17720, Councilor Paul Boschman to petition the city to add a berm in front of 78 St. Joseph's Ave in order to address water and sand issues faced by residents in the winter. Berm should be placed at the start of the sidewalk to the berm on Daniel Street. And this was held during the July 2020 meeting.
Yeah, I think that was held because Gary had a problem with that particular petition. I don't know if Gary could speak to it.
I don't remember this petition exactly.
There was a long discussion, and we just said it didn't make sense at the time, but I don't know if anything's changed since then.
No, I don't think so.
Yeah, so I haven't heard anything.
Okay, Councilor Boschman's not here to speak to it, so why don't we continue to hold it?
Yeah, makes sense. Meeting. Make a motion to continue to hold it.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
It's unanimous. Is there any other business before we adjourn? Can I get a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
And we'll take it by unanimous consent that we will be adjourning. Have a good night, gentlemen. Thank you.